On Nationwide this evening, the ice and fire of Waterford Crystal glistens once again in the city. The Waterford City family of stone carvers who have been through the thick and thin of business for several centuries. And the story of the businesses which helped shape the life of Waterford City and made it what it is today. That story is now told in a new book. And you're very welcome to the programme. And this evening we're looking at some of the crafts and industries which make Waterford City the vibrant place it is today. And behind me here is a scene which many in this city feared would never happen. It's been described as being like a phoenix rising from the ashes as Waterford Crystal is reborn right in the heart of the city. And this multi-million pounds development will be officially open tomorrow after an immensely turbulent time in the industry, which is known to all and sundry in this city simply as the glass. Damien Tiernan brings us this report on the new House of Waterford Crystal.
Waterford Crystal is back in Waterford, and this is its new home, the House of Waterford, as it's going to be known. The first visitors have already started arriving, admiring the high-tech manufacturing facility and visitor centre developed through a partnership with Waterford City Council and WWRD Holdings, the company who purchased Waterford Crystal, Wedgwood and Royal Doulton last year. 1,300 people applied for the 90 jobs here, a combination of designers, master cutters and retail jobs. It's a far cry from the early 1980s, when at its height, Waterford Crystal employed more than 3,000 people in the city and county. And there were thousands more working in secondary or indirect jobs. In fact, it's hard to think of another city in Britain or Ireland that was so dependent on one factory. Entire streets and housing estates were even built in the 50s and 60s to house the employees and their families.
We're in St John's Park. We came out here in 1960 when I was all of 2 years old. It was a new working class housing estate built in the late 50s. And when we got here, the houses on the other side of the road there were known as the glass factory houses. They were purpose-built for the workers in the glass factory sometime in the early 50s. And they were at first largely populated by the master blowers and master craftsmen that the factory management here in Waterford had brought over from factories throughout Europe, largely from Germany and from Italy, but also from Poland, from Austria, from Czechoslovakia. It was a wonderful place to grow up. It was like, in a way, like living in the United Nations.
This road became known as the German Road, as Jim, who did a series of radio documentaries with Liz Reddy on Waterford Crystal, explains.
Well, I don't know why they said the German Road. They might just as easily have said the Italians. I mean, if I give you some of the surnames, there was Corelli's, Giusti's, Defenses, they were all obviously Italian. There was Kretzens, there was Mullers, who were Polish, Austrian rather, there was all sorts of nationalities here.
Nearly all those who came to the German Road originally from abroad have now left, but there are still some living in the city.
German Road was home to me. I was brought up on the German Road, I knew nothing else. All I knew was my parents were not Irish, they were Italian. We went to school. School was difficult because I started, my first language was Italian when I was being young, and then eventually when I went to school I actually had to learn to talk English. So that was strange, but I had two languages, which was more than some, and then when I started actually in school I had three because I started doing Irish. So it was just quite natural to be on the German Road. To me, we were from John's Park and knew nothing else.
Still living on the German Road is Maurice Bomber Flavin, who worked all his life in the glass, as Waterford Crystal was fondly known locally.
And you were there back in 1949?
Yeah.
What was it like when you were starting?
Oh, it was terrible. The conditions were terrible. I don't know. Some fellow said the other night down the pub, but you're still alive. I can't help that, you know. Oh, the conditions were wicked, wicked.
What type of conditions?
Well, the windows were only like all my windows in the house. And there were four furnaces inside here, mate. And you're only from here to there away from them. You know, and you're trying to make, let's say, 300 glasses before the break, up to 12 o'clock. and 250 after the break. That's 550 glasses in a shift.
Those working in the furnaces were given two bottles of stout and sometimes salt tablets daily to help replenish the massive amount of salt they lost sweating.
We used to get two bottles in the morning and two in the afternoon. There's two. Drink it there underneath. It's the best bottle ever drank. No glass. Stay in the bottle is better all the time.
Bottle of beer or stout?
Stout. And he'd give two little tickets. At the end of the week, then he'd make them up and you'd have to pay for them, of course, then. You wouldn't be getting them for nothing.
Why would you be drinking them? Would you be losing so much weight?
The sweat. And the eye on your leg there, the jeans, you see, be going hard from the sweat. All white rings there on the jeans. That was the salt. I used to give us out salt tablets. Every so often, I get the salt tablets. Just was hard going by.
What was it like living on the road with all the nationalities?
It was a crack. That was a bit of a crack. Oh, I could see an Italian going down with a frying pan in his hand. And chips or something, and going into the other house. Oh, Mom, not me. And he's shouting and roaring. They couldn't call me Bomber. That's a nickname on me since I was a
Bomber.
Kid. Bomber, yeah. Mommer, I used to say.
Jerry O'Connor, now deceased, was purchasing officer for over 35 years at the company.
Between the whole family, I think they're probably my brother, sister, dad, etc. I think there's probably about 200 years of service between the whole lot of them with Waterford Crystal.
The O'Connors say everybody got on great on the German road.
They were nearly all gone when we came over here. They were nearly gone back to Germany and Yugoslavia and different places they came from. But they were all right fit. Most of them were all right. They ate the pigeons.
Many people started working in the glass from the age of 16. And the influence of the company on all aspects of life in and around Waterford was massive.
We were very aware of the Crystal factory here in Waterford City being, you know, having this incredible heritage and culture and history. Even as like 10 or 12 year olds, we were all very much aware of it. Not in a great big marketing sense, but just there was something going on in the city that was special, that wasn't anywhere else.
I started in 1977. I was 15 and a half years of age. So I wasn't the only one at that stage, you know, 15 and a half, and you think back now, it was mad, you know, straight out of school, you know, and I was working here for 27 years, you know.
Waterford's proud history of glassmaking goes back to the 1700s, but stopped for a time because of British excise taxes. Charles Batchick and Murislav Havel restarted it in 1947, and Murislav trained everyone.
I was only producing something which we were able to do with the apprentices.
Yeah. Nice.
Because first time we got a few continental craftsmen.
Yeah.
Well, that was when we moved to Johnstown.
At one time, the Waterford Crystal factory in Dungarvan employed nearly 800 people. Workers here and in the city were always very generous in supporting causes and charities.
People were great, you know, around the town, people were great. Everybody in town benefited, I think, from Waterford Crystal as regards sponsorship. Like, I mean, I know myself from collecting for people around the town. Everybody in town probably has a piece of Waterford glass, you know, in Dungarvan and Waterford. We would have given a lot of sponsorship to clubs and pubs and schools and you name it. Everybody had something to sponsorship from the glass factory.
They were extremely well paid by comparison with other industries in the town. And we were jealous. But as I grew older, I recognised fairly quickly that they were very well paid for a very good reason, that they worked extremely hard. I mean, other than fishermen or miners, I genuinely don't think there was a tougher job in this country than the men who blew that glass and cut it. It was extremely hard work, and I'm delighted to say that at the time they were well rewarded for it.
As the years went on, many external factors caused major pressures on the company. There was also a significant industrial dispute in the early 1990s.
Today, the union was laying plans to keep the pickets in place 24 hours a day to ensure there was no production and that no crystal left the plant for the marketplace. They rejected criticism of the fact that the strike vote was taken on a show of hands rather than through secret ballot, saying that nobody objected when they agreed to accept £8.5 million in wage cuts on a show of hands.
And in the years that followed, many other factors came to bear, which caused enormous pressures on the company.
The difficulties that arose, particularly in relation to Waterford Crystal taking over Wedgwood,
And the company just went downhill after that. And Water Crystal just were, the profits from Water Crystal were being used to prop up the Wedgwood loss-making end of the thing.
Various survival plans were tried, but then in January 2009 came the shock the company was closing. Staff staged a sit-in, a prolonged sit-in, and the government and former management came in for a lot of criticism over redundancies and pensions, or the lack of them. And then the famous furnace at Kilbarry was finally extinguished. But now, after a year and a half, a new light has been lit. This new venture in the heart of the city is on the mall, and the old ESB offices and council yards out the back have been transformed. But the devastation and shock of Waterford Crystal having closed is still reverberating.
There are unemployed people as a result of it, and there are families that are devastated, and that's extraordinarily difficult and extraordinarily sad, and has contributed to the difficulties that Waterford faces. But having always remembered that, we have to now move on. And there are a lot of good things happening, like the birth of the visitor centre. The visitor centre was a terrific success when it was in Kilbarry, and it was very sad when that folded. But now it's going to emerge like a phoenix rising from the ashes. Just down the mall here, a new Waterford Crystal Visitor Centre, which in my view may be even more successful than the last one because it's in the heart of the city.
We're going to have a facility that will have a 2-ton tank producing 40,000 pieces of crystal a year, using local tradesmen, using traditional methods of crystal manufacturing, mouth blowing, hand cutting all the crystal. And within the retail brand experience, we'll have the biggest, largest showcase of Waterford Crystal in the world.
I was born in Mears Walk, which is like 5 minutes walk from here. And I walked to Johnstown, the old factory, back in the 60s. And now I'm back again in my little hometown, right in the heart of the town, in the most beautiful part of the city. This is like the mall is the most beautiful part. It's the old Georgian part of the city. Right behind us, we have Christ Church, which dates back to the 14th century. We have Regina's Tower, which is 1,100 years old. And here we are with this wonderful, iconic, beautiful brand, still going, still preserved. It's incredible.
And the House of Waterford Crystal officially opens tomorrow and no doubt will provide a welcome boost to tourism in the area. Now, this is Michael Street, right in the heart of Waterford City. And no surprise to find here banks, fashion shops, trendy cafes and so on. Rather less probably is this craft industry, which has been thriving on this site since the 1700s. And now the next generation at O'Keeffe's Monumental Works is looking forward to bringing this 250-year-old industry into the future.
That one there cleaned up well then.
So you want new chippers of hand?
Yeah.
Right. The other one is down here somewhere, I think. I think it's on the left-hand side, if I'm not mistaken.
The family business started back in 1772. My grandparents and relations and that were used to work here over the years. It was always family-orientated, father down to son and completely down that way.
We're the eighth generation. The eighth, Jimmy and I, and it's, my sons are here, my two sons are here, and Jimmy's son is here, and that'll bring us to the ninth. So however long more they last, I don't know.
But years ago, we used to quarry our own stone and quarry it in Kilkenny, and then we'd take it here and cut it. Now we don't. We get slabs in and do all the work here now. We don't do any quarrying anymore.
Well, it was very, very hard years ago. Everything was done by hand. No, I mean hand, a hammer and chisel. And everything was done by hand. It was really slavery, but just, they had no other way of working. That was the thing in those days.
It's changed a lot since my father's time, my grandfather's time. It's hammer and chisel, a lot of hard work. And now there's a lot of machinery, so it makes it a lot easier, but it's still a hard job.
All the styles have changed and the material has changed. Years ago it was all limestone quarried in Kilkenny and Carlow. Now it's all imported granite stone. Very little Irish stone being used.
men here years ago, they were here for years, for 50 years, some of them. And there were some of them making headstones, others then just putting on the lettering. We had great pride in our lettering years ago. And you'd get a slab on and you'd put your lines on the stone and mark on your letters by hand and then start cutting. Nowadays, it's completely different. There's all computers now and much handier, of course. The stone here was all carved out of limestone. It was all a big, thick stone, and it was all worked back down to allow for the heart to be raised out. And then it was all carved inside that. All the grape and the vine and all that was all done by hand, and you can see the work as the very detailed work that was in it. Stones like that were the rich people could only afford that type of stone. You know, the amount of work that went into it, the hours of labour and that. It was a very expensive stone at the time.
This one was done back in 1999, just commissioned by the priest here, Father Ladan. It took a couple of months to do on and off. Just Celtic knotwork, mostly, and the doves then to represent the millennium, just for the cross. I've done a few Celtic crosses around, but nothing as big as this one. Well, there's not much demand nowadays for the Celtic crosses. It's nice to be able to carry on the tradition that it can be done still today, because most of the stone is granite, and it's just proud to be able to say that I can do it.
As the youngest member, I suppose it's an honour to be working here and working with the uncle and father. I suppose. But times are changing, and there's a lot of different machinery and newer machinery that they've never had when they were my age in it. So I suppose it can be a bit easier for me in that sense. Well, I'm proud to be working in the yard, and I hope that I can add something to it. You know, that'll take it on to the next generation.
Well, this family business has survived, I think, because we take great pride in our work, and it was always drummed into us to do a good job, and I hope that we can pass it on to our sons, as they pass it on down through another generations of that. And all you've got to do is go to a cemetery and see our work. Several people have said to us that you'd notice the difference between years of somebody else's, you know. But we're proud of it, very proud of it. We're glad that we've kept the business going here, even through bad times, which we have now at the moment. And we're still struggling to keep going. And hopefully we will be able to hand it on to the next generation who are working here at the moment. And they can hand it on then in years to come.
And long may that family tradition continue into the future. Now, down through the centuries in cities like Waterford, well, all sorts of businesses have come and gone, given changing markets, technology, wars, recessions, and so on. Well, two men here in the city have taken on the job of producing a book of images which recall the various trades, crafts, and businesses which have made Waterford the city it is, which shaped the city, you might say. And the result is the publication of A Century of Enterprise in Waterford.
I'm Andrew Kelly, and together with my friend Bill Irish, we have put together a book called A Century of Trade and Enterprise in Waterford. It's a collection of photographs depicting life in Waterford over the last 100 years. I mean, I've been collecting old photographs for 40 years, and in collection from Bill's previous book, which is the history of shipbuilding in Waterford, and that book was centred a lot on trade. So that's where the idea for this came, that we would look at other trades that were in the city and county. And we just went back through the old photographs that between us both, and then sourced it from other people as well.
The significance of this book is that it documents for us, I suppose, the history of the importance of Waterford City as a transport link in throughout the ages. No matter what page you get it, that's what you see, transport. The river, name in Irish, Ontuir, sister river to the other two rivers in this region, the motorways of their time allowed people from wherever they came to access an enormous area of the country. And that's what built Waterford as a great port and as a great city in the Middle Ages.
The photographs of the quay that we have in the book cover about 100 years of the city, if you like, and they show a lot of the trade and enterprise in the city over that period of time. Port would be the lifeline of the city. It was where the trade came in and went out from, and water would have been a major exporting port at the time, and has been up until even the present day. Waterford is still the same vibrant city as it always was, and particularly this street, which now has shops lined the street, but one time would have street traders that would have plied their trade from cockle sellers to knife grinders to cobblers on this footpaths. But this street still links to the quay and would have been the main connection with the quay.
This book is important for future generations in that it documents our ability to make everything here, the self-sufficiency of the local community, be it from ships to shoes to shirts. We could do it all. We could make everything. We made everything. We imported and we exported. We functioned as a great historic city and a great historic port. Things that even like Jacob's cream crackers, ours, that we exported all over the world.
I think the present generation should know what the forefathers were and what they had to do to make their grub at the time. And it's good to have that, because we are in a change in our country now at the moment. The world is in change, and the day you stop, you're dead. We've got to get on our feet again and get this country going.
Yeah, I think it is important to have a record of what the city was like and how people lived and traded down through the period of time for the younger generation coming up. And who knows, maybe there's someone else will take it and follow on from here.
Wonderful images there of times past here in Waterford. And do remember that the House of Waterford Crystal will be open to you from tomorrow. That ends our programme for this evening. Do join us again on Wednesday next, when we'll be meeting people from other lands and getting their perspective on doing business here in Ireland. Until then, from Waterford City, from all of us and your nationwide team, a very good evening to you.